session. It's a secret or a surprise. Is it neuro-linguistic programming or is it natural language processing? We'll see. We'll see in the next minutes. So, Bobby, it's your turn.
Or maybe Bob.
It's good that it's not NPM.
Not package manager.
Okay, so I'll start with the.
Может Bob as well.
The boost.
Как уже на
So, are there any English speakers in the?
We have one Austrian and four Soviets.
Okay, so I can try it in English. Okay, so I'll start with two disclaimers. So the first one is that this is an NLP natural language processing, and the second one that this won't be a Java presentation. It's more like artificial intelligence in some Python. And
no JavaScript.
No JavaScript. At least I won't show it.
So Java is not a natural language.
It's general purpose.
Okay, cool. One question. What means artificial intelligence?
you start with the top questions. So there is a distinction between, for example, the human intelligence is natural intelligence, and the artificial intelligence is just pattern recognition. Nothing more.
Image recognition,
everything that has recognition inside. Or
so it's not intelligence, it's just
it's
image.
Not intelligent at all, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Most neural networks can be represented with a single regex.
yes.
So
it's louder.
Louder?
You can use the mic.
Just use
the
mic. Yes,
okay, I'll try the mic. Oh, is it on? No.
On the bottom.
Is it on? Is it on?
Светик?
Red light.
Speak inside. It's the home. There is
it. Is it on? Is it on?
Watch it.
Is it on? Okay, I'll speak louder.
Is that the church?
Okay. So can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I'll start with a little bit of introduction, why we even need NLP and how did it came up and why it's gaining popularity now. So this graph shows something very interesting. You can see in 2006, this is actually a graph, I'm not sure where it came from, but it should be official. This is sounds trustable. So as you can see, in 2006 we had only 0.1 zettabytes of digital data. This means all the data stored on digital carriers around the world. And now we have, 47 zettabytes, which is exponential growth. And the percent you're seeing there is how much of this data is structured. Or in other terms, how much of this data can be fit into a table or an SQL spreadsheet or something like that. The rest of the data is, for example, plain text or voice message or chat message or email. Basically, you cannot extract anything meaningful from this data without some sophisticated methods like NLP, for example. So some use cases for NLP. Well, text analysis, what I referred here is you can extract features.
No, it's not working.
Again.
It just stopped.
I think the battery is dead.
Maybe the red light is.
You have to click it underneath.
I'm clicking it.
I'll just speak louder.
Okay, I'll try to speak louder. by text analysis, I mean extract some features about unstructured text. For example, who is the, I forgot the word in English, glagol, podlog.
The verb,
and things like that for the words inside the sentence and document. Another very common use case is document classification, text classification. Similarity between two texts, generation of text, although this is not yet working in any way. Translation and other things like voice recognition is also, I think, part of any of, oh, sorry, part part of NLP. So, before we even start talking about natural language processing, we need to talk a little bit about the thing that powers everything below. This is actually a pretty simple structure of neural network. Basically, we have layers of nodes. It's a graph. Every node from the previous layer is fully connected to each node of the second layer. And that's pretty much all of the structure of the neural network. And every connection has weight. And inside every node, there's something called activation function. So this process you're seeing here is mimicking the actual functioning of the brain, which dominating theory is that our receptors send us electric signals and they travel through the brain in a certain way. For example, something like this. The higher the signal from the neuron is, the wider this connection will be colored, the border. The idea is that similar things will cause similar patterns in the brain. Same things happens in the neural network. So similar input data should travel through in a similar way through the nodes. One more thing to mention. This is about digital recognition in this case. Neural networks work only with numbers. So mm-hmm. You cannot pass it text, you cannot pass it anything besides numbers. And they cannot be, they won't, you can use not only integers, but also doubles and so not whole numbers. This is a simple structure of this is the actual structure of the artificial neuron, every node that builds this network. So as you can see, the Higgs represents the input from the previous node. The W's represent the weight of each link. And basically what we do to provide the input for this particular neuron is multiply every Higgs by every W and sum everything up to make one number. And every neuron has one output number. So this is, wondering should I put this slide at all, but this is the activation function which received this number, and there are plenty of activation functions and they're pretty simple. There are just one function call which transforms this number into something, another number. It's not very important. Okay, so every neural network has this thing, the thing you saw before. This is the sort of the architecture. So how are we going to shift things around? How are we going to align them? And the next step is to train the network. So the training means updating the weights of the links. Basically, we start with randomly generated numbers for every weight, every link, and there are several approaches we can take in order to train the network. So, the most commonly used, and the one I'm going to be showing you in a moment, is supervised, which means our training data is organized in input and output examples. Yes.
So, just one question, please. So, we make the neural network and we choose only one type of activation function, right? So,
every layer has single activation function.
Yes, but it's the same for all neurons.
No, for the layer.
For the layer, for so the next layer can have another
yes,
activation.
Yes, they usually
function.
Have different activation
okay.
functions.
Okay, thanks.
Also, some people choose activation functions for specific neurons. I don't know why, but they do it. It's, in
okay,
my
so
opinion,
this is also possible.
It's also possible. But designing the network is pretty complicated. Usually when I do something, I copy-paste from somewhere else. So the difference between the different training methods is the way the data is fed to the network. So in supervised, data is organized in pairs. We have an input example, some numbers, and output example, the expected result of the final layer of the network. I forgot to mention something, that the first layer is called input layer, the last layer is called output layer, and everything in between is called hidden layers. So we're interested at the moment only in the input and output. So in unsupervised approach, we are not sure what our data, for example, in unstructured text, we don't know anything about the text. So we rely on the network to form clusters, to try to figure out some connections in unstructured data. The reinforced learning, so
basically Skynet will be a reinforced learning algorithm because we define some data. The data is usually, for example, in self-driving cars, it's the environment. So we feed numbers representing the environment around the car. And we define something called penalty system, which gives the neural network points for doing things right and takes away points when it, for example, hits someone on the street or doesn't stop on red light. And at the end, it updates its internal state and builds the neurons, basically generates a new neural network, which then can be used to power the self-driving car. So all of these approaches use a similar training algorithm called gradient descent. So it's a mathematical term, but usually it's referring to minimizing the function based, it's not that important. Basically, we travel through the network, for example, in the supervised way. We have an input, we see what the network predicts as an output, and we measure by the loss function, measures how far off are we from this prediction. And then we travel back and update slightly every link from every node in order to come closer to the solution.
And what happens in the unsupervised way?
In the what?
Unsupervised, can you use gradient descent for the optimization?
It's always gradient descent, but in unsupervised, it's always something custom. There is not single algorithm that can solve every unsupervised learning.
But you kind of specify a way to validate the results, or how does it?
You just observe them.
What?
You just observe them. I will show something unsupervised in a moment.
Okay.
So, in practice, do you use only one of these training methods, or you combine them?
Well, most of the more modern models, I mean, the model is the result from the training. The neural network produces models. So most of the modern approaches are built from several neural networks. So you can have six models working together to form the output. So
what about the loss function? Sorry.
The loss function is basically measuring how far off are you from the expected output. And this can be done in many ways.
How wrong are you?
With a number. So this is basically
the
back propagation in action. I took some GIFs from the internet. So as you can see, we allow the network to predict something. It predicts something, and we measure how far off it is from the expected output, and we update the weights. So just a little bit of clarification for this particular example. This is image recognition problem, which is we have data set of numbers. All numbers are converted to black and white. Every pixel is represented with a number. It's from 0 to 255. 0 is black, 255 is white, and we form this input vector for each image. So this is how the input is generated. And the output is basically an array of 10 elements, and every number has single, this one hot encoding. You have zeros for except the position of the number. For example, 3, 0, 0, 0, 1, and zeros.
When you say vector, it's like a two-dimensional array.
It's an array.
And it's just an array. One dimension.
Because when you say vector, you can make.
It is, yes. I mean, your picture is a two-dimensional array.
Two-dimensional array.
You make a vector of it, you just make it one dimension.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We just concatenate all the lines of the images. So I have prepared them for this particular thing. And it's in Python. Before you start. So basically, I will be using a library called Gensim. They already have algorithm. This, sorry, wrong demo. Okay, so I have a bunch of code here. I don't want to show it. But we're going to be using a data set.
It's on camera now, so it's over.
We're going to be using a data set called MNIST, which is basically some American university invented some discipline where students had to write digits and label them. to get credits. So now we have 60,000 labeled images to work with. So I'll just show some of the images. So you can get an idea how they work. I ignore their messages. So this is one image. And they're already converted into the numbers we talked about earlier.
So, there are exceptions.
So I ignore it. Warnings. There are warnings. So basically, this is the place where we're going to build the neural network, which we saw in the presentation. So sequential means feed forward. The network that starts from left and moves only to right. Dense layer means fully connected, every node is fully connected to the second one. And image size is 28 by 28 is the total number of pixels in the image. So, so here we are omitting the input layer. It's automatically created. And we have one layer of this amount of neurons. Second one, this is copied from some paper, I forgot the name. And we have output layer of 10. And there are different activation functions, as we mentioned, for each layer. They
one
are defined
question,
by layer.
So you have 784 pixels,
yes.
And you have only 512 neurons.
Mm-hmm. So this is, I just said that the input layer is omitted in the configuration. So you just you define the first layer and define
I mean
how much it receives. And
okay,
that's
so
the input
it
layer.
Doesn't receive
So basically the second layer that you specify as a hidden one should have the input dimension of 512.
That's yeah, this one.
Ah, you basically
okay,
change
okay.
Them together.
Yes.
Understand.
Because it's this is activation function which is fit specifically designed for classification problems. Adam is sort of gradient descent algorithm modification, and this is for logging. So we load the data from dataset and do some things with it. And at the end we say fit, which means the data will start traveling through the network and updating the weights. We specify this parameter, means how many iterations we're going to have. So one iteration is all the data traveling once through the whole network.
So
we'll do this five times.
So basically the gradient descent is enough. You're basically getting an approximation. Like, can you specify, a way of saying that if the weights are not changing by some delta, you need to stop, or you can only specify how many epochs you.
Well, it's configurable, but not with this library,
okay.
And the algorithm is pretty long and complex, so we have to understand what you're doing. There are a lot of problems with this algorithm. I'll mention some of them later. Basically, the main problem is called diminishing descent, diminishing gradient or something like that, which means that because we're updating the weights by slightly on each layer, the further we go with the layers, the less effect our updates have. And if if the network is too deep, we cannot train it with this algorithm. And there is no other way to train it. So this is a major problem. So the testing happens pretty fast, but why not wait it? Ignore the warnings. So this was the test story. I'll just show you what it outputs real quick. So the training data is split into two parts. Basically, in this case, we split we use 50,000 images as to train the network, and 10,000 images which the network never saw before to test whether it will predict them. So what the network logs while it's training is how far off, how well did it predict the images. And we can see only in the first iteration we already have 0.98% accuracy. So it predicts all of them with 99% accuracy, which is basically human level.
So using TensorFlow or Keras here?
It's just import.
No, I mean, if you use really Keras.
So Keras, yes. Mm-hmm. Keras with TensorFlow backend.
Keras is over the TensorFlow.
Yes. So to test it, I have this method. Basically, we feed the data at once, and it will predict all the examples, and we have this predictions array. So I have, first I'll run it once, and it will tell us how many times it got the output wrong. So out of 10,000 examples, it had 399 errors. So I can draw the images that were not. So for example, this one, I'm not sure if you can see it. So the network predicted 9, but the expected label is 3. So either the label is wrong, or someone doesn't know what 3 is. So this one is the network predicted 9, but the one that thought that it was 5. So, and there are plenty of such examples. So, for example, this is 0, this is 3, this is 8, and so on. There are 4,400 of these. All right. That's pretty much it for the network. Not waste any more time. So, this gets us to the part where basically the current state of NLP. The main problem with natural language processing is that words are very complicated and every word has one meaning in one context. Could be something like there are complex expressions like metaphors, humor, things like that, that it's extremely hard for algorithm to comprehend. So some researchers at Google figured out a way that had this idea that the word is described best by its context. So basically you can judge a lot about a certain word by its surrounding words. So they gathered huge amounts of data and started examining how words appear in contexts. And they managed to build some very interesting relations between the words. So a little bit more details about how are we going to achieve this is, first we need to encode these words so we can feed them to a neural network. The way we're doing this is by the so-called one-hot encoded arrays, because they're not vectors. It's the same thing as with the numbers. Every word has an index inside an array of size, the total number of numbers in our training data. So for example, in this case, Rome is the first word, so one on the first index and the rest are zeros. Paris, and so on. So this is actually pretty useful. It's called embedding. And people have been using this for the last 10 years to classify documents. They represent words in such way, in this way. And the bag of words is just a representation of whole sentence in the same vector where every word is increased in the specific index. For example, if you have two occurrences of the word Rome, I'll have here two. This is the bag of words. So this was before word vectors. So now, the researchers at Google designed this neural network, so it's flipped. It's the same way, it's the same neural network that we used in the previous example, just with a different architecture. So basically, the first input layer is all of the words in the surrounding context. We take one word, and basically we have something like cursor, which moves through the text. We take five words from the left, five words from the right, or this is specific, this is configurable. We take out the word and feed these 10 words to the neural network. Then they're represented by their one hot encodings. And in the middle, the hidden layer, there's one single layer, which is usually very small, for example, 300 of size. And it manages to capture some features of these words in this way by updating the weights. And the output is the missing word. Not sure if I explained it incorrectly, sort of. So there's also the flipped approach, where we ask the neural network for the surrounding context efforts. So this one works better for smaller data sets, and this works better for the larger data sets. So, as I mentioned, I have a demo for using GenSim. So as you can see, during this process, we end up with, this is why it's called vector, because it's not just numbers, but something that can describe the words in a certain way, and you can form some relations, and you can plot these vectors on a plane. So basically, words that often appear together will be closer, and words that don't appear too often together will be far apart. The second part is not very guaranteed. Mm-hmm. So,
isn't this more like a word, not vector, but a cluster?
Well, the cluster is formed afterwards. When you have the vectors, you can form the cluster. So the training is very simple. So we have our training data. Basically, I've trained word vectors for Bulgarian language. I've downloaded several websites, for example, Chitanka.bg and BG Mama and Data.bg. But I think I removed BG Mama and Data.bg because they have a lot of curse words. So. So there are too many. So basically, there are several input parameters here: the size of the vector, which is the size of the hidden layer, or how many features we would like. This is achieved by experimenting. It's not some golden rule that you should use this number. The window size is how many words are going to take from left and from right. So we'll have an input layer of 10 words. Mean count is how many times, the minimum amount of times a word should appear in the context, otherwise it's cut from the training. And how many iterations. I won't run it because I don't have enough RAM on this computer. And it will die. So I have it pre-trained, and I'm serving it with this Python server. I won't show the code. I'll just run it, and
what
I have
kind
a.
Of machine do you need to train?
Well, I can train it on this one as well, but at
not
home
quite.
I have. It requires a lot of RAM, because it needs to load everything in the RAM. So I have 16 gigabytes of RAM. It's working fine, but for the later algorithm that I'm using, I wasn't able to run it locally on any of my machines. That's why I don't have demo for it. Or is the cloud and pay Google, yes. So I've created a very simple UI, so we can show it. Have word demo. So basically, it will give us the words that are close by context to the word we're providing here. Some interesting things. It's not just words, but for example, we can ask it for Sofia. It will give us other Bulgarian cities. And if we ask it for
this
London,
trend with which website?
Sorry?
Chitanka.
Okay.
It
will
you
give
us
other.
Rakia?
Sorry?
Can you tell with Rakia?
One thing that I found very impressive is that it can recognize names, for example, Maria, and it will find other woman names.
It's also a name, Marika.
But it's also a city, so it's more used as a city than a name. That's what's so It's not number of occurrences, but in what way the word was used in the context, more like. It's not occurrences.
For humans, it's important that Sophie's name, not only.
Yes, but this is the major problem I'm going to talk about later. This is the context. So in one context, it will be a city. In our context, it will be a name. So this is the major problem. So the clusters, I have them for them also. So basically, you can define sort of like abstractions, pick up words from a certain group, and I've decided to pick these words, and then you can use this algorithm to search for similar words in text. So basically, I'm downloading this page and search for our words that are close to any of these words. So you can use this, this is called actually feature extraction. Oh, no, not entity extraction. You can search for certain objects by their meaning. Okay. We could try with different websites, but you get the idea in different words. I'll post the code later. And also, we can measure similarities between phrases and words. So it's basically comparing distance in the vectors. Nothing more.
Try with minor.
What?
Minor.
Minor.
Okay.
Curse words. This is just a... I'll delete it later. It's all written. Let me try. We can see which words are close to it. It catch the Bulgarian spirit. This is why I removed DataBG from the training set. It was polluting everything. This was pretty. Okay. So, a little bit more about the problems of Word2Vec before we continue. So, the context. The context is the major one. Also, for longer sentences, for example, in similarity, we're just averaging vectors. So, I can show it, but it's not that important. But for longer sentences, they always appear the same. So, this is again by coming from the way that contexts are represented in this case. So, we cannot use word vectors to find similarities between larger texts. And this is a major problem for the Google search engine. Also, we cannot use word vectors to find links between phrases, another major problem for the search algorithm. So this is why they invented this one. So this is not an invention, but sort of like, the previous one was called Elmo. So I'm pretty sure that they are just making the words up so they can form something. That is interesting. Basically, this is a mixture of 5 or 6 neural networks that work together, and they are separate things. And three most important things are the. Okay, so examples for what we're going to solve with this algorithm. So, for example, this word here, it's pretty easy to understand by us. It's obvious that the first sentence is referring to the cost of the river, and the second one is referring to actual bank when you can deposit money. This is not at all obvious for the algorithms. This is even more complicated. So, for example, this is referring to the same entity in the text. This is from Wikipedia. So, the words in green refer to the same thing. The Stephen Tower. So they're using a little bit different type of neural network. It's again similar to the feed-forward one. The only difference is that it's when it produces something, it feeds it again to itself. Mm-hmm. And it does this in for every word you feed it. So for example, you train these networks with sequences of data. So one example is one sequence of data. So they form these long chains, and the diminishing this descent we mentioned before is very strong here. So again, for longer phrases, it's very hard to keep track of the error rates and how we should update the weights. Currently, Google Translate works using this algorithm. They are just linking phrases to other phrases from different languages, and they are using word vectors below to encode the words. So basically, word vectors provide a unified way of encoding every language to a number. And then when you encode this to word vector, you can transfer this vector to everything, like, without needing any translators or anything. This is a huge achievement. It was done 3 years ago.
One question, please. This rectangle, which is A, is it the whole network or just
this
one?
This is the whole network.
So
they just draw that.
In order to be recurrent, the number of input channel, the input layer must be the same like the output layer, right?
It's not mandatory. I mean,
but then you need some kind of mapping.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
There are special mappers for this. Yes, there should be a mapper.
Essentially, you feed the output in the input in some way.
In
that's
okay.
The important part. So this is the also known as decoder encoder encoder decoder sequence to sequence. This is how translations work. So basically, the first recurrent neural network, this is just calls to the recurrent neural network, they encode a vector of the phrase. This vector is fed to the other recurrent neural network, which is specially designed to translate from German to English. And it can sort of like, it performs some mathematical operations on the vector. And it keeps track of the updates. Which, I mean, the most complicated thing here, which was extremely hard for me to understand, is how does the second, the decoder knows the length of the phrase it's going to produce. And it's actually pretty complicated. I'm not sure I can understand it, but it's basically some vector operations. And this special symbol that they're providing determines when the sequence will end. Recurrent neural network. Mm-hmm. Oh, so the problem is still here. For longer sentences, the vector gets you push words, you just average the vectors, and you lose track of the context eventually. So for longer phrases, again, this is not reliable. Mm-hmm. This is why Google Translate cannot translate long phrases or translates them to some random things. For small phrases, for single words, it works very well. This is because it cannot keep track of the internal state that is changing, passing through the network. This is the diminishing descent problem. And they invented a mechanism, which is another network, which can focus at one point at the word that is being observed. This thing also can find relations between the relations between in the Steven Tyler example. So I'm on this word, which words are important to me at this moment, or how similar are the words from the phrase at this point to me. This way we can pass in, sort of like they're referring to it as a hidden state. So transformer performs its operation, the vector moves from the transformer, and there is one hidden state that constantly is moving with the transformer, and these two vectors together form a lot more contextually aware vector. So the end result is the Google BERT update. Basically, it affected 10% of the indexed internet, which is a huge number. And by affecting, I mean that articles that shouldn't be on the first result page went to the second or the third. They were absolutely irrelevant for the search phrase. So Google, in order to search, they have basically the algorithm is composed of two parts. First is how this current search phrase relates to previous search phrases. And once you have this connection, you can use the other connection, which is how this search phrase refers to this document. So there's a two-step process. So firstly, they have a lot better understanding of how the phrases are similar to each other, and then how this phrase describes this document. So in this case, you can see that the previous result is very broad because it misses some parts of the context. And yes. I'm not sure how I will do time. Okay. So that was pretty much it. I'm not sure if I missed something.
How does reverse work?
Sorry?
In a reverse, this matches two languages, several languages in text.
What that is? Well, in most cases, you know the language of the text you're processing. So. Okay, so that's pretty much it.
Can you elaborate what's the improvement? How are you getting the context? What's the optimization?
The optimization comes from here. Essentially, we are again training word vectors, but in contrast to the word vectors we mentioned before, the vector for the word is formed on the basis of the phrase.
But it works for short phrases only.
For short phrases, yes. But we need the mechanism.
It's still big achievement.
Yes, 50% of the internet
yeah.
Index.
Okay. So there is a new English. There's American English, British English, now Google English. So. You want to translate something to short phrases.
Yes. I think I skipped some parts of the demo. Probably. That's why we have 10 minutes extra.
Short on the other hand, I guess they shouldn't be too short because Google Translate also has an issue when you doesn't have the context.
Mm-hmm. Same with when you're trying to extract something.
Mm-hmm. So, what's the optimum basically that it can best.
I think 100 words,
100.
Something like 100 words at the moment. Mm-hmm. After the 100 words, it becomes absolutely irrelevant what it produces. But even with 100 words, I don't think it's working that well. Mm. I can say a few words about the classification, so which I forgot to mention. Currently, the classification of documents works by averaging all the vectors from the similarity of the documents, averaging all the vectors for each word in document and comparing them with the same thing with the other document, and it's working with 98% accuracy at the moment. So this is already solved. I forgot to mention it earlier. Okay, some resources I've gathered. I've uploaded everything on this repo with the links. Okay. That's pretty much it.
Okay, so thank you, and we promised lunch, but it's